Been flying solo for so long, nobody singing the harmony. Up there just me and my shadow, no bass, no guitar, no tambourine. And I found you like a melody, you were singing in the same key as me. We had them dancing in the streets. I don't wanna be a one man band, I don't wanna be a rolling stone alone, putting miles on a rundown van. Maybe we could take our own show on the road. I'll lay down the beat, you carry the tune. We'll get tattoos and we'll trash hotel rooms. Baby, take my hand. I don't want to be a one-man band. Chase every high with you, count every rip in these old jeans. We'll never learn how to sing the blues. If I'm gonna be famous, girl, I wanna be famous with you. We got our own little groove. I don't wanna be a one-man band. I don't wanna be a rolling stone alone, putting miles on a rundown van. Baby, we could take our own show on. We'll get tattoos and we'll trash hotel rooms. Baby, take my hand, 'cause I don't wanna be a one-man band. When the spotlight goes cold, the curtains come down, the chairs are all stacked and there's no one around, and nobody's paying, we'll still be playing. I don't want to be a one-man band. I don't want to be a rolling stone alone, putting miles on a rundown van. Maybe we could take our own show on the road. I'll lay down the beat, you carry the tune. We'll get tattoos and we'll trash hotel rooms. Baby, take my hand, 'cause I don't want to be a one-man band.
No, I know what it is. I'm having problems tonight. I'm trying something new. Bear with me. Down on the boardwalk, they're getting ready for a fight. Gonna see what them racket boys can do. Now there's trouble busting in from out of state, and the DA can't get no relief. Gonna be a rumble out on the promenade, and the gambling commission's hanging on by the skin of its teeth. Well, now everything dies, baby, that's a fact.
maybe everything that dies someday comes back. Put your makeup on, fix your hair pretty, and meet me tonight in Atlantic City. Well, I got a job and tried to put my money away, but I got debts that no honest man can pay. So I drew what I had from the Central Trust and I bought.
All right, folks, good evening and welcome to the first sports desk of the 2020 year, calendar year. We're going to talk some bowling tonight with Jeff Riggles with us from the 11th frame out there in Wisconsin. And at 7:15, we'll have John Williamson, who is the Vanderbilt women's bowling coach. They're in Vegas this week for the Storm Blue and White Classic that's sponsored by the folks at Mount St. Mary's here in Maryland. And then Bill O'Neill, the PBA bowler, will join us at 7:30. So we're on the phone with Jeff Riggles right now, with us right now. So Jeff, just talk about Happy New Year. Just talk about this year, bowling starting up in a week or so down there in Texas, you know, the professional bowler store. But bowling has been going on even before the holidays.
Oh, yeah. I mean, even in what would be, quote unquote, the off season, there's a lot going on. Guys can go overseas. There's tournaments, say, in Korea and Japan and elsewhere in Asia. There's some folks over in Finland right now for the Ballmaster. And, of course, they had the China Tiger Cup in November that was an invitational or an earned invitational for seven of the top PBA Tour players. Just finishing up, and what I'm sitting here writing about now, finished last night, was the Team USA trials for 2020. Big and very complex competition to help determine who's going to represent and wear the red, white, and blue for the next year. So lots going on, and of course, everybody's excited for the first year of the PBA Tour kicking off next week with Bolero as the owner and all that they may see different and new and bigger this year.
Yeah, and it's very fascinating that you got the new folks taking over, and but Tom Clark is still going to be there, plus the new lady, Miss Edison will be there as well.
Yep, I actually have been working and just finishing up here. I had a long interview with Tom. He is now just the commissioner. Collie Edison is the CEO, so she basically, the easiest way to think of it is she handles all the business stuff. And Tom is now, instead of doing both roles, is able to focus on the bowling part of it, the competition. And there's a few new wrinkles, improvements, I think, that the players wanted this year. More one-squad tournaments for squad equity and a few other things. There won't be any five-on-a-pair tournaments except with a couple exceptions. I'll be four-on-a-pair. And the whole tour is really stepping up in a lot of ways. Of course, Bolero put in $400,000 in additional prize money that'll boost some of the majors to $100,000 first, along in the playoffs, PBA playoffs, staying there. And also, kind of something the average person doesn't notice, but a guy like me of modern day, I was a hack marginal player in my couple of years on tour. They will like that there will be a 1-in-3 cash ratio again. So that means, let's say there's 99 players in a tournament, 33 will cash versus, okay, say if there was 100 and only 25 would cash under the 1-in-4 ratio. So be a little bit easier for the guys who aren't Belmo, Bill O'Neill, Sean Rash, Anthony Simons, and those guys. The guys below that will cash on a little more consistent basis and hopefully pay the bills a little better. So that's kind of neat. Long interview with Tom, and I'm hoping to get that posted at 1130.com on Friday. I did it in just a straight Q&A format, so he has lots to say about all those things and much else.
I know this time last year, nobody expected Norm Duke to win two titles. You know, Norm was part of the, you know, the 50 and older crowd. You know, he bowls once in a while, like with like Pete Weber. Is there anybody from that crowd in the 50s, you know, and older that might make a impact this year?
Well, I mean, you can count Chris Barnes there because he's going to be senior tour eligible for the first time this year. He's had some back problems with the surgery that he had a couple of years ago. But I still got to think Duke, because the thing that he has that is something that almost no one else on tour has is the ability to go dead straight up the lane on almost any condition and create something for himself that almost no one else has out there anymore. There are no other guys that really do that anymore. Walter Ray Williams obviously could, but he's a super senior now.
Wow.
He's 60 years old.
Wow.
I think he turned in November. If I might have that wrong, I'd have to look it up. But if he didn't just turn, he's about to turn 60. And so, I mean, nothing against Walter. It would be cool if he could pull lightning out of the box. But, boy, if you saw someone 60 years old win a tour title, it would break John Handegard's record. So I certainly wouldn't expect that. He might be the one guy that could do it. Pete Weber is supposedly much healthier, been working on his hip and back very much. He's talked about that in a couple interviews and is really excited to bowl again. The problem Pete has is that his ball speed is so slow. I compete with these guys on the senior tour, so I see him when I get out there a couple times a year. And he still throws the ball unbelievably, still one of the greatest releases in the history of the game, but his ball speed just gets it just doesn't really work out on tour anymore because of the young guys and their 600 rev rates and their you know, chewing up the oil and everything. It just isn't that. But that's the natural order of things. What Norm Duke did last year was so unbelievably incredible. People over the age of 50 are not supposed to beat people who are 25 and 30 years younger than them in sporting competitions, are they?
Yeah, I agree with you. You know, people like my father's age, and you know, I'm 38 years old. You know, getting, you know, but it's fascinating now. All the people I used to watch in 1980 and 80, you know, in the 80s and 90s, early 90s, now they're like 50 and 60 years old. You know, like Danny Wiseman, he's like 50 years old now, and I said, "You're 50?" And he goes, "Yeah, thanks, buddy. You know, I appreciate that." You know, but you know, cause I'm still thinking.
Yeah, he's a typical guy with he's had a lot of health problems. He had a car crash that messed up his neck and. You know, and I've talked with Danny, and I mean, he's bowled some senior tour stuff and does well, but you just, the things, the aches and the pains and all that, you're not going to compete with guys that are 25, 30 years younger than you and in peak physical condition. And that's, like I said, that's what just makes what Norm did just so incredible to win 2 weeks in a row. But that was on one of those two pattern tournaments, which the craftiness, the experience, the savvy, the shot making and all that stuff that you might find a little more in an older guy came through. And this year we're going to, instead of having three two-pattern tournaments, there's going to be six.
Mm-hmm.
So that you know, maybe that's a couple more opportunities for guys like Norm. We'll see. Obviously, every time they get up there, the great thing about that is the fans go bananas because who doesn't like effectively, even though they're among the greatest ever, they're underdogs at this point in their careers, and who doesn't like to see one last time see you? Imagine when Tiger Woods is going to be out at the Masters when he's 54 years old, and if he makes a run, just like, you know, Tom Watson did at the British Open a while ago. That's just automatically something you got to cheer for.
Yeah. And, Jeff, I'm also excited that the United States Open is back on the tour schedule on TV because I heard they moved it to October, and I'm like, that's not traditional bowling for my age. When I was a kid, it used to be on February, you know, before the, the stop at True Value, Open or whatever it was, and then you got to, you know, Baltimore. But you know, I'm glad it's back on the TV side of it here in the winter time, so people could see the United States Open.
Yeah, Tom talks some about that in my story about the schedule. All five majors this year are going to be contested during the first just over 3 months. They'll all be done by early April, and it'll all be on the Fox Sports portion of the tour. It's going to be an intense 3 or 4 months here. There's going to be some guys frying, and you know, if somebody gets hot, they could do what Belmo did a few years ago, maybe win three majors. But it's all going to be packed into there. It's going to be going to be just crazy for the next few months, and you know, and then you've got the PBA playoffs right after that, and then PBA league in the summer, and Tom talks a little bit about what's to come after that, some scoops in my Q&A, talking the tour beyond the PBA league, some of the stuff that's going to come later in the year. So it won't be the end of the year when the Fox schedule is done, but boy, it's going to be all the major stuff is going to be in this fun part of the year. And that's great for the PBA. For people who might think, oh, why? Who wants that? Traditionally, the highest ratings bowling has ever gotten on TV shows have always come in January, February, March into April, when the old winter tour of the ABC TV contracts were. That's when people are home generally more, and will, you know, bad weather in there, and sit in front of their TV, and we'll watch more. So it makes sense to have all those tournaments front loaded like that. So it's a good thing for the PBA to have this, and there'll still be chances to see those guys the rest of the year.
So when you talk to Tom, I know you're going to write this out, and folks, if you want to read it, it's going to be Friday at the 11thframe.com, his Q&A with, you know, Tom Clark. But did Tom talk about expanding the tour, like, back to the old days? Like, you know, when I was a kid, I think this weekend is the, back when I was, like, 4 or 5, it was the AC Delco Classic. And then you went to the Showboat, and then you went to, Texas, and you went... They went all over the place until, like, April, when they went back to Ohio for the Tournament of Champions. Are they going to do something like that, or is it just that's a sign of the times?
Well, it's pretty darn close to that. There is a more shows, I believe, in the first 4 months this year than, or as about as many as there were in the old Winter Tour days. Remember the World Series of Bowling we're going to have in mid-March there. We're going to have a Sunday afternoon show live, a Monday night show live, a Tuesday night show live, Wednesday night the PBA World Championship live, and then the taped USA versus the World on Thursday. So it'll be 5 shows, 4 live in that 1 week, and we've got bowling virtually every weekend from not this weekend, but the next weekend will be the PBA Hall of Fame Classic show. There's going to be bowling virtually every weekend between now and early April. It's going to be as close as it's been to the old days in a long, long time. And I watched Flow Bowling tonight, had Jason Del Monte on from Australia talking about the fires and some other stuff, and also then talked about the tour. And he said the schedule's so jam-packed that he actually will not even go home to Australia once in the first 3.5-4 months of the year.
Wow.
Once he comes over here, he's going to pay to have his family come and visit him here, but he just, you know, the travel, there's just so many tournaments and so much competition to go back and forth. Just there isn't enough break time in there to make it feasible, and he doesn't want to miss all these big tournaments that there's going to be these first few months.
Exactly. Well, Jeff, thank you so much for coming on tonight, and if you want to stick around, 7:30, we have Bill O'Neill, who won last year's Hall of Fame Classic, beating Jacob Buckriff by, 3 pins?
Yeah, I think it was 199 to 194. Jacob had a spare miss in that game, and ironically, I also did a Q&A with Bill, and I'm hoping to get that one posted maybe next Monday or Tuesday, right before the tournament starts, where he's defending champion. So I'll take a chance to listen to that if I haven't crashed into bed for my 3 a.m. alarm at 7:30.
Yeah, I think what my mother says, right minds think alike. You know, we think the same thing. So, all right.
Well, he's a natural for you to have. He's a defending champion for next week. So
exactly.
I'm sure people will be glad to hear from him.
Yes. Well, we're going to take a break here on the Sports Desk. We'll get John Wilkinson. And Jeff, thank you so much for joining us, and we'll talk to you throughout the bowling season.
Anytime, Chris. Happy to be on.
All right. We'll be right back here on the Sports Desk here on HerbFM Sports Radio.
This is a recently re-recorded one. Called Peace Train. Lately, thinking about the good things to come, and I believe it could be something good has begun. Well, I've been smiling lately, dreaming about the world as one, and I believe it could be someday it's going to come. Someday it's going to come. Come take me home again. Come on the peace train. Someday it's going to come.
come on the peace train. Come take me home again. Peace train sounding loud, light on the peace train.
All right, folks, welcome back to the Sports Desk here on HerbFM Sports Radio. And speaking of Vegas, this week a big women's bowling tournament for the NCAA women's tournament out there in Las Vegas, Nevada, you know, where you could lose your money and you may not fly back home in one piece, but, you know, we know some people over the years. But the bowling's out there. It's the Storm is sponsoring the Blue and White Classic. It's sponsored by Mount St. Mary's University here in beautiful Emmitsburg, Maryland. So John Williamson is the Vanderbilt women's bowling coach, and they came in runner-up last year in the women's tournament there in Ohio. So, Jeff, happy New Year. John, happy New Year. So talk about how's Vegas right now.
We're sort of excited to get back to starting the spring semester, and really excited about the tournament coming up. You know, Josie Barnes, my assistant coach, is on maternity leave, and this will be her first tournament back. And the fall was sort of a grind. And, you know, I think with getting Josie back and sort of getting the dynamic that we're used to, we should be back to being pretty good.
Yeah. So you guys have been out there the whole week, right? Because you have some of your ladies bowling in the USA time trials, right?
Yeah, we had seven competing in the team trials, and it also doubles as the U.S. Amateur Championship. So we've been out here since a few of them been out there for longer, but we've been out here since the 2nd.
Okay.
And we'll be out here till the 12th.
Wow. Well, talk about this tournament. You guys, I know Mount St. Mary's, I talked to Kenneth DeGraff yesterday on the phone. I know he's flying out as we speak, or he's already there. But I know he started this thing, ball rolling, you know, last spring or summer with an idea about bringing women's bowling to Las Vegas for college bowling, because nobody really does that in Vegas, because it's more or less the men's and women's tour for the PBA and the WBBA does their tour stops every year. So just talk about this event. Do you think it's going to be one of those every year you guys are going to be part of it?
I think so. It'll be interesting to see. For us, our girls started school on Monday, so they're going to miss an entire week of school this week. So it'll be interesting to see what they think. It'll be interesting to see what their professors think in terms of, like, sort of consistent involvement. I think the timing makes sense, because if it butts up with the U.S. Amateur Championship, there's a decent number of people who are already out here, so that's sort of I think the reasoning why now is the time that he's doing it. Mm-hmm. And it's a great bowling center, the South Point Bowling Arena. It's great for spectators. It's great, you know, for the girls to be able to compete in a facility like this. So for us, it was a great opportunity. To bowl in a great place and, you know, against some pretty good teams. So we thought it was sort of a no-brainer.
Yeah, you have I was looking at your roster. You have a young lady who's from Australia. I know Australia is having a lot of issues with those wildfires. Has Emily been in contact with her family and see how everybody okay?
It's interesting because we've been on the Christmas break, and Emily's not here yet.
Okay.
So I haven't had a chance to talk to her about the stuff going on back home.
Okay.
You know, I'm sure that it's a thing that's affecting her in some form or fashion, just because of the size and magnitude of it.
Yeah, I think it's probably affecting travel, and probably people can't get out of there because of the air quality. It's probably that's also the problem.
And her immediate family has moved to the States.
Okay.
And her brother plays football at MTSU, and her parents live in Tennessee. But if she has relatives and stuff, I'm sure affected by it.
Yeah. Well, you also have a senior from Perry Hall, Maryland, who we talked to you about her last year. She's part of the you guys have like a 5-player format, right? So she's going to probably be one of the seniors who'll be bowling this weekend.
Yeah, Brianna's gonna be bowling this weekend. She spent last semester she was student teaching. So her performance was limited because to be licensed in the state of Tennessee as a student teacher or as a teacher when you graduate you can only miss a certain number of days. So she wasn't able to travel very much with us. So this will be sort of her first tournament back with us too. She competed in the team trials this weekend and this past week, and she'll look to give us a spark this week.
Yeah. Well, last year you guys played. You guys made it all the way to the TV finals for the national championship. You played Stephen F. Austin, right? And you guys came up short. Mm-hmm. Do you feel like your players have a little more determination this year? I know last year's last year, using a football term, but. This is still like when back in some of your girls' minds that you want to get back to where you were last year and probably hopefully bring it home.
Yeah, I think that there's a little motivation in that. I think that anytime you get close to something and it's definitely anytime there's you're that close. We won it in 2018 and we were. Just a couple of shots away from winning it in 2019. And so, our senior class would love to have two national championships, and, the juniors would love to have two national championships. And so I think that, that sort of adds some fuel to that fire. And, when you're close to something and it doesn't work out, you can only hope it motivates you. We don't spend a lot of time talking about last year. We don't spend a lot of time talking about 2 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
But I know that our girls, have their eyes on bigger things and say this regular season tournament. But for us, we just have to take it sort of one week at a time, and hopefully we can get back and have an opportunity to to compete for a national championship.
Yeah. Well, one last question to ask you. I was looking at your schedule, and you're heading towards, after this tournament, you're going to Pennsylvania and then back to Texas, and, you do the Arkansas State Tournament in Jonesboro, where the PBA stop is probably a week before that
right.
or something. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Just talk about the expenses that you guys have to do. Do you guys have to do this out of your own pocket, or does the university, give you, a budget and say, this is how much you need for travel and all that stuff?
We're lucky the university gives us a budget, and
okay.
we sort of have to fit it into that budget.
Mm-hmm.
It's nice because our budget, it's flexible, and that, if we want to come here and spend 10 days in Vegas with the vast majority of the team, we have the budget to do that. So, the girls don't have any expenses. We don't have any personal expenses. It's just, making it fit in sort of the budget from the university. And when we choose the tournaments and stuff that we go to, it's, a combination of trying to find tournaments that have the most, the best competition, and trying to put us in areas that are good recruiting areas to go
mm-hmm.
to. So we can always sort of have a presence in those different regions for recruiting and trying to put ourselves in a position to make the postseason.
Exactly. Well, John, thank you so much for coming on tonight, and good luck this weekend in Las Vegas. I know you guys start, I think everybody gets there tomorrow, and then I guess you guys have practice, on Thursday, and then I guess everything goes according to plan on Friday when you guys have the Baker matches, right?
Yes, sir. Today's sort of a day that we sort of have off because it's didn't make sense to fly home, and we've got a couple that are flying out here today, and then tomorrow's practice, and then we get it going on Friday.
All right. Well, if you want to watch John and the ladies from Vanderbilt, you could go on to theflowbowling.com. You can sign up. They have plans from $12.49 a month, or you could just listen to us next week. We'll get the winner of the tournament and the top three teams come on and talk about how they did.
Awesome. Well, I appreciate your support for college bowling, and thanks for having me on.
No problem. That's John Williamson, the women's bowling coach at Vanderbilt, coming up at 7:30 in 5 minutes. We'll talk to a a local bowler who is from this area, but, you know, he's from Pennsylvania, Bill O'Neill. We'll talk to him. He's the defending champ of next week's tournament, and we'll see how he did the rest of the 2019 season. You are listening to the Sports Desk here on HerbFM Sports Radio. We'll be right back. HerbFM Sports Radio, and we have on the line with us a professional bowler who last year who won this tournament coming up. The Professional Bowlers Tour is back on Fox Sports 1 starting next weekend, but the tournament starts down in Arlington, Texas, the Hall of Fame Classic, and we have Bill O'Neill with us, who is the defending champion, who beat Jacob Buckriff by a score of 199 to 194. So, Bill, congratulations on winning last year. What was the feeling like winning the first title of the 2019 season?
Well, first of all, thanks for having me on. Appreciate it. You know, it was kind of came as a surprise a little bit that to win that event. I had some close calls on making the shows. Like the previous year, I had a lot of sixth place finishes, and I just couldn't quite get over the hump to get on the show. And you know, my goal for last season was to get back there and to make two or three shows and, you know, try to slowly get myself back up to, you know, where I wanted to be. And to make that show and, you know, to bowl as well as I did for those first couple games and then to not have it go great the first couple frames and be able to pull myself out of it to get the win was, you know, something that definitely springboarded my entire 2019 season for sure.
Yeah, and then you went on to, in the summer, you won a tournament in Virginia, and then I met you in Delaware, and, you know, that Gene Carter's Classic. Just talk about your summer tour. You seem like you started off pretty well, the same as your winter tour.
Yeah, I mean, I got the win in the first of that August swing, and I did it in a way that I probably, you know, wouldn't have been able to do in the past, and that was with urethane, and I was able to slow my speed down, hook it a little bit. So, you know, I felt really, really good about winning that event and leading it. And, it helped me, you know, confidence-wise going to the rest of that summer swing. I mean, unfortunately, when I saw you in Delaware, I kind of had a disastrous finish to that event. But,
right.
You pick yourself up from those moments because you know you had – you know, stuff to build on previously, and it can, you can kind of shake those off a little easier.
Yeah. Well, I know you guys are, I know you're good friends with Jason Belmonte. I know he's going through his country, going through with a lot of wildfires. Have you had a chance to speak to him, and, you know, are you going to help him in his cause?
Yeah, it's horrible what's happening down there, and, he's going to, you know, we're trying to figure out what it is that we can do. You know, I know he put something out there with what he's going to do with donating some money with, you know, based on his strikes on the show. And he actually just reached out to a few of us today that he's putting something together, I believe. And, yeah, I'm definitely going to help him out. So I think once I'm able to meet up with him, we don't have to do it over a text exchange. We can kind of figure out, you know, what I can help with. And, you know, being so far away, I'm not, you know, I kind of don't know exactly what is needed from, you know, for people like me. So I'm, I'll get with him next week, and, you know, we're going to try to figure out how to best help out.
All right. Well, talk about this. You guys are bowling at the training center now for the, you know, the Bowling Hall of Fame has now moved from St. Louis to Texas. Let's talk about this facility. It looks pretty cool.
Yeah, it's a cool, you know, facility. I was fortunate enough to be on Team USA for 7 years. In the last 5 or 6 years I was on Team USA, we were able to be at the training center and, get a lot of work in down there and, you know, tour the Hall of Fame and all that kind of stuff. And it's really, really neat place to be down there. So, I'm looking forward to getting back there.
Yeah. Well, I know that when you won your titles last year, you have 11 titles now. Are you considered being in the Hall of Fame, or what's the new criteria now for the Hall of Famers?
Yeah, I guess technically, you know, by the way, the rules are now, I'm eligible to be, you know, voted on to be in the Hall of Fame. I'm not guaranteed to be in the Hall of Fame, but you're eligible to be up for the vote. You know, I'd like to, at, you know, whatever time that comes, I'd like to have, no doubt in my mind or anybody else's mind that I deserve it, so I'd like to go out and win a few more times for sure.
Exactly. Well, what do you think about the new bowling now with the new owners? You know, Tom Clark is now the commissioner. He's not Mr. Everything of the professional bowlers. What do you think about the new owners taking over?
I'm looking forward to it. I think it's a pretty exciting time for us as professionals. I know that Bolero's pretty motivated to expand us, in whatever way they can. So I think, you know, just by, you know, starting out and adding some money to our majors and just kind of, giving us the feel that they're, you know, just super invested into what we're doing. And I think they're going to have a lot of great ideas that, you know, sometimes we get stuck in the, bowling mentality of this is always what we've done. So we're just going to keep doing it. And that, you know, that we do that a lot in bowling, and hopefully, you know, they can come in with some you know, fresh new ideas and ways to increase our viewership.
Yeah. Well, I wish one day I could get back to where I was a kid. I used to watch bowling on every Saturday afternoon at 3 o'clock, and it was, like, all over the country. You know, they started in California, and you probably did the same thing, you know, watching ABC Sports and, you know, wishing, like, oh, I would love to do bowling those tournaments. Is that the same feeling that you wish they could do?
I think, you know, it doesn't necessarily have to be Saturdays or anything, but
right.
I think, you know, the consistency level of, when we're on a certain time or just, you know, because that, that's just what it was back then. We, you know, afternoons on Saturday mornings, you could catch bowling, and everybody kind of knew it. So, you know, we had a bunch of years where we were just kind of all over the place, and, you know, we're very beholden to the network, so we're just, you know, catching any TV spot we could, and it's, you know, it's hard to grow your audience like that, and I think that, you know, now that we're on our second year with Fox, I think they're, you know, they're doing a great job, and I just, you know, I think we're in a much, much better place than we were, say, 3 or 4 years ago.
Oh, I think Fox is doing a fantastic job with Rob Stone and Randy Peterson and Kelly and Kimberly Prester, and I think everybody's doing a great job on Fox, and I feel like this is just like almost like the old days, but not really.
Sorry, I didn't catch up.
Oh, I'm saying Fox is doing a fantastic job doing, you know, covering bowling just like ABC used to do a long, long time ago, but I feel like it's getting back to where it was, but it's not where I was a kid and everything's on TV at 3:30 on Saturday.
Sure, yeah. I mean, I think it's a slow build, and I think you know, the first year of anything, I think, you know, when people take over things like Fox just did with us, now Bolero's taking over the tour itself, I think it's, you know, you have to kind of have a feeling out process and, you know, see where everything is, and, you know, Fox kind of added some things there, you know, towards the end of the year to help us, you know, help the shows look better. I mean, in the playoffs, they had different, you know, higher quality cameras. They put them in different spots to show different angles, and they had an interview desk and a broadcast desk there with Rob and Randy and Belmo and Kyle. It was just a lot of different things that they were adding in from year one. So I think, you know, in a couple more years down the road, we'll even look back and think, wow, this is even coming even further. So. Yeah, I think we're all pretty happy and pretty excited.
Well, Bill, I know you have to get ready to travel, but thank you so much for coming on. Folks, you can follow Bill, Bill O'Neill, and the rest of the gang of the Professional Bowlers Tour. The final, Step Right In Finals, the top five, is on noon at 1 o'clock on Sunday, January 19th on FS1. And then the Tournament of Champions is actually on Fox at 5 o'clock February 8th, right?
I believe so. Yeah, we'll have a few on the main network this year.
That's cool. So, well, Bill, I hope to run into you down the road throughout the 2020 season, and good luck on next week down in Texas.
Absolutely. Thanks a lot.
All right, folks. That's Bill O'Neill. We'll be right back here on the Sports Desk in a couple minutes, right here on HerbFM Sports Radio. We'll be right back. Sports Desk here on HerbFM Sports Radio, a little classic Professional Bowlers Tour from 1990, the theme song. So thanks to Bill O'Neill for stopping by this evening. In the meantime, we forgot to play an interview around 7:08. We were supposed to play Ken DeGraff is the bowling coach at Mount St. Mary's out there in Emmitsburg, Maryland. And I had the privilege to speak to him yesterday by telephone, because he's out there right now getting himself ready for his big tournament this weekend. We talked about the Storms Nation is sponsoring the Blue and White Classic right here this weekend in Las Vegas. Not right here, but in Vegas. So here is the interview I had with him yesterday afternoon.
Hi, Ken. It's Chris. How you doing? You're like me last week. Oh, wow. And when are you guys flying out? Tomorrow? Oh, okay. That's cool. Nice. Hopefully the snow's over by then. So, yeah. So, yeah. Oh, okay. Cool. Well, let's talk about this tournament coming up this weekend in Vegas. We talked about it a month ago about refresh everybody's memory. How does this tournament got started? How did Mount St. Mary's you guys get involved with a tournament in Vegas?
This is a recently re-recorded one called Peace Train. Lately, thinking about the good things to come, and I believe it could be something good has begun. Well, I've been smiling lately, dreaming about the world as one, and I believe it could be someday it's going to come. Someday it's going to come. Come take me home again. Come on the peace train. Someday it's going to come. Come on the peace train. Come take me home again. Peace train sounding louder. Light on the peace train. Come on the peace train. Isekaya. Is out on the edge of darkness, there rides the peace train. Oh, peace train, take this country, come take me home again. I've been smiling lately, dreaming about the world as one, and I believe it could be someday it's going to come. Someday it's going to...
All right, folks, sorry for the technical difficulties there. We will try to get a hold of it. We'll try to fix that another time for you folks. We're going to take a break here, and in a minute we'll get a hold of our good friend Todd Kapamowicz, who writes for Sports Illustrated Raven Maiden, but he does a lot of stuff at CussBox.com here in Baltimore. We'll talk Ravens football, Ravens Titans, Saturday night down at M&T Bank Stadium. We'll be right back here on HerbFM Sports Radio.
Woohoo!
All right, folks, we're going to change our tune here on HerbFM Sports Radio to some NFL football. This weekend, a big divisional playoff game downtown with our good friend Ty Karpinich, who writes for Sports Illustrated Ravens Maven. That's a brand new Sports Illustrated thing, but does a lot of stuff with the PressBox.com and does a lot of local sports around here as well. So, Todd, big game downtown this weekend between the Ravens and Titans, and I feel like the X factor in this game is the Ravens got to control Derrick Henry, or else Derrick Henry is going to be running into the AFC title game without the Baltimore Ravens.
Well, that's the key. The Ravens think if they can shut down Derrick Henry, they're going to win the game. They're going to try to make Ryan Tannehill beat them, so they're going to stack the box and try to shut down Henry and maybe make Ryan Tannehill try to beat him over the top. But the Titans don't have, you know, their receivers aren't able to get separation against the Ravens. And they'll have a tougher time against the Ravens secondary. So, and then Bill, and then also Tannehill, you know, they say, you know, he's one of the better quarterbacks in play action. But the Ravens say, you know, if they shut, you need to have a running game in play action. So if they shut down the running game, make them one-dimensional, they like their chances.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, if you control, like I said, you control Derrick Henry, because I think Derrick Henry ran through the Patriots, and I think he's still running as we talked. Yeah, right now.
Yeah.
But Tannehill is not that great of a quarterback, because we know about Tannehill's history. He was terrible, a dumpster fire in Miami, and Miami got rid of him for Fitzpatrick, and now he's in Tennessee. And where in the world is Mariota?
Well, I guess Mariota. Well, apparently he's running the scout team this week. He's tending Lamar Jackson. Chris Vrabel says he's doing a pretty good job on it, but we'll see. Tannehill only attempted 18 passes against the Patriots because they put the onus on Derrick Henry to win it. And as I said again, if the Ravens shut Derrick Henry down, it's going to be a long day for Tennessee. And I think the line's back up to Ravens at minus 10.
Oh,
wow. Las Vegas likes the Ravens, too, in this one.
Yeah, I think so. And like I said, the road of the AFC title game goes through Baltimore. And, you know, I know the last time Baltimore had a major game in the postseason. Yeah, I don't want to say last year was against the Chargers, but I know years ago, I think they won against the Colts. Yeah, that was a major game.
Yeah, it was 1973, I think it was, or 72.
Yeah.
It was against the Raiders, yeah.
Yeah.
The last time the championship game in Baltimore. Yeah.
It was 77. I think I was reading that the other day, but, you know, but it goes to the post. I think my dad knows all about that game instead of we do.
Oh, that's what it is. It's the AFC Championship. Yeah, there was a playoff game when the plane crashed, right?
Right, I think so. And something like that. But I'm just saying, the last time the Ravens were favored in a postseason, I feel like I don't want them to get too cocky on Saturday night, knowing that, yes, you got the home crowd, you got all your people out there tailgating since 2 o'clock in the afternoon, you know, getting liquored up and having a good time. And coming out flat, and to the point like Tennessee runs them out of town, and now we got to wait for the Orioles to play in April.
Yeah, and that was sort of a focal point this week at Ravens practice. They were asked, you know, Lamar Jackson, Earl Thomas, Mark Andrews. They were all asked about whether they were worried about being rusty because, you know, they had the bye week and the layoffs until they saw. But they said, no way. They said they're locked in, they're focused. They were able to use, you know, Lamar Jackson's battling the flu. He's 100% healthy. Mark Andrews was dealing with an ankle injury. He's 100% healthy. So they used the bye week wisely. And they're pretty locked in. The biggest question mark is Mark Ingram, who suffered a calf injury week 16 against Cleveland and didn't play against the Steelers, and he hasn't been able to practice this week. So he's still a big question mark. But again, the Ravens have Gus Edwards and Justice Hill. Those guys ran for over 200 yards against the Steelers. They're a pretty good run defense. So I think the Ravens are going to be in good shape regardless if Mark Ingram shoots up or not.
Yeah, and I think that's really good that you have four or five different running backs that actually can fill that hole. And the Ravens haven't had that in years because they used to have Jamal Lewis and, you know, I think they had Ray Lewis, and they didn't have anybody to back them up. So now you got Mark Ingram. If he goes down, you got, you know, Gus Edwards and, you know, and what's his name? You know,
Hill.
Yeah, Hill. And you feel confident that they know the playbook and you should be okay.
Yeah, and Edwards, you know, of course, he led the team in rushing last year as a rookie. So, you know, he sort of backed up, you know, Mark Ingram most of the year, but he's a proven commodity. And number two, because Mark Ingram carried the load most of the year, Gus Edwards is pretty fresh heading into the postseason. He's averaging 5.1 yards a carry. So he's going to be a handful for Dyton if Mark Ingram can't play. I think he's going to get his carries regardless because the Ravens really like what they see from Gus Edwards.
Yeah. Well, you know, I know we're talking about the Baltimore game, but let's talk about the other games if you want. You know, if you want to, you got that 4 o'clock game on Saturday before the Baltimore game, Minnesota and San Francisco. This is like the old back in early '90s when Joe Montana was facing Chris Carter and all those people in Minnesota. You know, what do you think about that game?
I think Minnesota has a chance to beat them because of their defense. You know, they had an impressive game down in New Orleans. That's a tough place to play, and that's a much tougher offense than San Francisco. So if Kirk Cousins can manage the game and put some points on the board, I think the Vikings defense can hold its own. But again, the 49ers have a bye week, they're healthy, and they're gonna be a tough out. But again, I mean, that game could go either way, but I think I still have to lean on the 49ers a little bit because of it. The year they had, they are the number one seed.
Right. And I just saw stats on ESPN. If the 49ers win, they're going to be they're going to tie the Pittsburgh Steelers for most conference championship games at home throughout the, you know, during the history of the playoffs.
Wow! Yeah, they have a lot of history there.
Yeah, that's
Montana, Steve Young.
Oh yeah, exactly. And then you got Kansas City, who is the second seed against Houston, and Kansas City doesn't do really well at home. They're 1-7 since 1995 in playoff games, and they won last year.
Yeah,
before they lost to the Tom Brady and the
Patriots.
The Patriots. So what do you think about that game?
Well, one call away, if that guy doesn't jump off sides, you know, they probably win that game.
Yeah, exactly. You know, you see Kansas City coming to Baltimore, or do you see Houston coming to Baltimore?
Oh, I think Kansas City's going to crush the Texans. I mean, the way the Texans played against the Bills, I mean, they were lucky to get out of that game. And I think Kansas City's pretty proud. I think they're going to take the next step in their playoff run, and I think they have just too many weapons for Houston. And I also think that the weather in Kansas City is going to be a factor. It's going to be cold. It's going to be windy, which, you know, the Chiefs are acclimated to. I think they just have too many weapons. I think it's going to be definitely Kansas City coming to Baltimore next week for the AFC Championship.
Yeah, and then the last game, Green Bay at Seattle, and Green Bay at this time of the year is probably it's not Hawaii, you know, so it's probably like, what, -4 or what, and with the weather we're having here this weekend. Like the weather
I like the Packers at home against the Seahawks. Seahawks, they're banged up. I mean, they got Marshawn Lynch in front of that. That's how injury-played they are. Although he did have a good game. He played pretty well. But I like Aaron Rodgers or Russell Wilson in this one. I think Green Bay's going to be tough. I think it's going to be a classic Green Bay-San Francisco NFC Championship.
Yep. And and it could be Baltimore and San Francisco rematch in the Super Bowl.
Yeah, it could be. And of course, you know, the Ravens beat them earlier this year, and that was one of the toughest games the Ravens played. You know, it went down through the final whistle with Justin Tucker. So that would be a tough rematch for the Ravens. But again, you know, the Ravens, they won 12 in a row, and they've beaten every team that they played, you know, the rematch of Cleveland. They beat every team of Kansas City. So, and they'll have a chance to do that maybe next week. So, The Ravens are deep and they're focused, and this is the best team they've had in a long time. And it appears that Don Martindale will not get a head coaching job, so he'll keep some continuity with the team. And now wait to see if the Browns will hire who they're going to hire. They're supposed to make an announcement on Saturday, but Greg Roman today declined to answer any questions about Cleveland. He said he's focused on this playoff game and that's it. But I did think that Greg Roman was a long shot to get that job.
Yep. Well, the last time Baltimore played Tennessee was last year, October 14th, it was 21-0 Baltimore, so it could be the same thing.
Yeah.
So.
And Ravens had 11 sacks, set a franchise record.
Right.
With 11 sacks in that game. And Tennessee's given up 56 sacks during the regular season. And the Ravens and Wink Martin, they like the blitz. So it's going to be the Ravens will be going after Tennessee. He's going to be scrambling back there for most of the game.
Exactly. Well, Todd, I was reading today. You did a nice piece on Lamar Jackson. Just talk about that. What did you get? You know, you got a chance to meet him all season long. He seems like a cool dude, right?
He's an impressive guy. And I'll tell you, with Lamar Jackson, you know, the biggest knock for him last year was him throwing the ball downfield. Can he be accurate? And when they lost the Chargers in the playoffs, he got back to work the next day and worked with his high school football coach, his quarterback's slash quarterback search all offseason in Florida throwing the ball. Worked all summer. He came back and he was throwing the ball. Since training camp started, we knew, we saw the improvement. He was throwing pipe spirals. He was accurate. He was throwing the ball downfield. And once he got that part of his game down, he knew he could run. And so, I mean, he hit there, you know, the game, first game in Miami. You know, mm-hmm. the second, first play of the game, he threw the 56-yard pass downfield to Marquise Brown. And the thing with Lamar Jackson, he's focused. He's a team guy. You know, he's already won several MVP, you know, awards for different media outlets. And he's declining, you know, he's deflecting them all. So the only thing he's focused on is the Super Bowl. And that's sort of contagious. And the players love him. He's a great guy to deal with the media. He's a great guy one-on-one. He'll sit there and answer questions, you know, all day until finally the PR staff is sort of like, they sort of pull him away.
Nice.
They want to get back, to work. He's a special guy. He's a really special guy. And the team is really rallying around him. And, you know, it's funny because he says, you know, he goes to malls now and he just is absolutely swarmed by people. And again, you know, he sits there and he takes pictures with every kid, signs every autograph, you know, and he's prominent. He's like, you know, I have to get some shopping done. So, yeah, he's in a city that's dealing with a lot of challenges. Baltimore City, you know, with crime and everything
right,
else.
Right.
He's sort of a beacon of light. People, the whole city is sort of rallying behind him. He's sort of like the local hero.
Exactly. Well, Todd, it all kicks off Saturday night, 8:15 on CBS, and you got Tony Romo and Jim Nance going to be there probably doing that game, and that's going to be an interesting game on Saturday night, and it's going to be 65 degrees, and you feel like you're in Florida on Saturday.
Yeah, for the rain, maybe.
So. Yeah, maybe rain, maybe. Right. Well, good luck. Enjoy the game. We'll talk to you hopefully maybe next week.
Sounds good. Thank you.
All right, man. We'll be right back here on the Sports Desk here on HerbFM Sports Radio.
Gets the snap, blitzes on, Rodgers scrambles
he's
left, winds up, rainbow.
Cobb.
He's got Cobb at the 10 to the 5,
yes!
To the end zone, touchdown, and a dagger! Oh my goodness, an NFC North Division Championship.
All right, folks, welcome back to the Sports Desk here on HerbFM Sports Radio in Baltimore. It's the top of the hour, 8 o'clock Eastern Time, 7 o'clock if you're in Green Bay or if wherever you are listening to us. Thanks for joining us. We have Wayne Larrabee with us, the voice of the Green Bay Packers. Packers are home this weekend against the Seattle Seahawks. So, Wayne, thanks for joining us. Let's talk about this big game on Saturday. I guess Green Bay has the factor with the weather and the Lambeau Field with the history and all that stuff.
Yeah, I mean, they've got some intangibles there. I'm not sure how bad the weather's going to be. I think it's going to be in the upper 20s, and we don't anticipate any major snowstorm or anything like that, but who knows? Things could change between now and then. But these two teams have a lot of history between them, and most of it plays out on the home field. The Packers have won two of the three playoff games in the series so far, and both of those wins were in Green Bay, and of course Seattle won the NFC Championship game after the 2014 season in Seattle. So home teams have carried the day so far in this one.
Yeah, they haven't played each other since last year in Seattle, and that was a close one, 27-24. Do you feel like that's going to be exactly the same this Sunday?
Yeah, I think it's got a chance to be a real close ball game. They seem to be somewhat evenly matched. Seattle might even have an advantage had they had their running backs, but they're down to their, you know, fourth-string running back, and then they brought on Marshawn Lynch. So maybe there's a little bit more of an advantage there for the Packers, but, you know, I no question Seattle, with Russell Wilson tremendously resourceful, they'll be good.
Yeah. Just talk about watching. I know you've been doing a lot of Packer games. You get a chance to see Aaron Rodgers, but you got a chance to see all the other quarterbacks, like, you know, Russell Wilson. What does he bring to a game? Because I know you sit there and you're like, wow, how does this guy get out of trouble?
Yeah, that's what he does. You know, he is probably the best deep passer in the league. And, you know, the other factor with him is that he's probably the best passer when he comes off the page. In other words, when he breaks, the play breaks down and they go into a scramble situation. I think he's the best thrower now outside the pocket. So the key for the Packers will be to keep him in the pocket and keep him contained, because he can beat you with his legs and his arm.
Yeah. Are you really impressed by the Packers this year? I know last year, you know, Mike McCarthy got let go, and then you got other people filling in, and then you got Matt LaFleur, who came from Tennessee. Were you surprised being 13-3 and having a first-round bye?
Yeah, I think everybody was surprised. You know, it just played out that way. A couple of factors involved. The Packers have been healthy this season. I think that makes a big difference for any NFL team. You know, and they've won some games that you sat there and said, hey, listen, going in, this is going to be a tough one to get. But they've been very good in that regard and finding ways to win. What makes people uncomfortable with the Packers is that for 25 years, it was all about the quarterback. And this year it's not. And, you know, the Packers win when Aaron Rodgers doesn't play lights out. And that's just unusual from what we've seen between Brett Favre and Aaron Rodgers. It was always the quarterback had to be played big for the Packers to really have a good shot at winning. But that's not the case now.
Yeah, you guys have a good running game, because I know a couple weeks ago against Minnesota, Adams had a 65-yard touchdown run, and I kind of lost my fantasy league. So I know you guys have a good running game.
Yeah, Aaron Jones has been great this year, and Jamal Williams will be back this week, and he's a great, you know, complimentary back to Aaron. And so I think this is going to be an interesting ball game this weekend, but the Packers should be pretty close to full strength.
Yeah. Real quick, I know you don't want to look ahead, but do you feel like Green Bay has a shot to go to Miami, maybe facing Baltimore or Houston or Kansas City or Tennessee? What do they? You know, I know you don't want to look ahead, but what is in your mind?
Well, I think anybody at this stage of the game has a shot. There's no doubt about that. Those wild card winners from a week ago, they feel like they're on a run right now. I know Seattle feels that way. They feel like they're the road warriors and have a good shot of winning at Green Bay. And who's to say they don't? The Vikings feel like they're on a roll now after that big win over New Orleans, and they feel like they've got a good shot at San Francisco. We'll see. You know, but I really think anybody has a shot at it. So, yeah, you can kind of project ahead. And, you know, actually, if the Packers can win their ball game this weekend and the Vikings upset the 49ers, the NFC Championship game would be in Green Bay. So it would be a tough one against the Vikings, but, you know, they'd have a great shot at going to Miami.
Exactly. Well, Wayne, thank you so much for coming on tonight. I know you're a busy guy. Enjoy the game this weekend, and we'll talk to you down the road.
Sounds good. Thank you very much.
All right, folks. We'll be right back here on the sports desk here on HerbFM Sports Radio.
If you change your mind,
take a chance
on the first in line, honey, I'm still free.
Take a chance
on me. If you need me, let me know. Gonna be around. If you got no place to go, gonna be feeling down. If you're all alone.
All right, folks, welcome back to the Sports Desk here on HerbFM Sports Radio. We have Everett German, who is the voice of the College of Charleston. The Cougars are on the five-game winning streak, rolling into Elon tomorrow night. You can watch that game on Flow Sports, on Flow Sports, you know, basketball, or you can listen to him on the radio if you have ESPN Radio 910 down there in South Carolina. So, Everett, thanks for joining us. You guys are off to a good start, 4-0 in the CAA. Just talk about this hot start, because I talked to Coach Grant the other day, and he said he credits the non-conference schedule that helped them out.
Yeah, when you look at the Charleston's non-conference schedule, it was pretty much a daunting one for a fact. You think about it, we play the Central Florida twice, Wake Forest, Providence, Richmond, BCU, Marshall. So when you think about all of those games and those teams and, you know, teams from bigger conferences, it definitely prepares you for what you're going to see at the CAA. There's obviously a ton of solid teams in the conference, but in terms of size and athleticism, none quite like what we saw in November and December. So I think the kids have really done a great job of kind of withstanding what we saw in the non-conference portion. And now that we're in conference play, it definitely has paid off.
Yeah. Well, you guys just got done a two-game homestand. You beat Towson and JMU. So what do you see from Towson right now? Because I'm going to see them tomorrow night against Drexel at home. They seem like they're a team that's kind of off and on sometimes throughout, you know, my observation.
Yeah, the big guy in the middle, Sanders, McKee Sanders, really played well. You look at the job that Pat Scarry has done, your typical Towson team, you know, big, physical, athletic, they're going to be monsters on the glass. They're going to do a good job in the paint. And they really kind of went toe-to-toe with Charleston, really about 10 minutes left to go in the second half. And then we were able to kind of pull away. I think our depth kind of took its toll on them, but yeah, I think you'll be very pleased with what you see tomorrow with Pat Scarry and the Towson Tigers, another solid basketball team that he has there.
Yeah, and then you guys, then you're back on the bus, you know, going down to William & Mary on Saturday. So it's going to be a little mini road trip for you guys. You've got to go to North Carolina and turn around and go back up to Virginia and back to where you guys are. So I guess a lot of mileage on that bus.
Well, yeah, I mean, we're on the bus right now, headed up to Elon, and we'll play Elon tomorrow, and then we'll bus from Elon to William & Mary for the big showdown on Saturday at 2 o'clock, and then we'll actually fly home Saturday night. So, you know, William & Mary, a lot of people are talking about that game with us being, at this time, the last two undefeated teams in conference play, but as Coach Grant probably told you, you know, the most important game is the Elon game. We're not even worried about William & Mary right now. We have to concentrate Elon team that on paper, they're somewhat, struggling, but we also know that they were going toe-to-toe with William & Mary, also hung with Lawrence Dcern, another solid team in the league, and, with a new coach, a new system, you can't take anybody lightly in the CAA, because if you don't bring your A game, you can easily lose to any team. So looking forward to battling Elon on tomorrow night.
Yeah. I was just looking at your roster. You have one kid who's from his local area. I'm going to say the Maryland, Delaware, Virginia area. A kid named Sam Miller is from Arlington, Virginia, who basically transferred from Dayton to you guys. What does he bring to the team?
Yeah, Sam, we actually played Richmond earlier at Richmond. The BCU game was at TD Arena. Also, he had a lot of friends and family come see us in Delaware and also Jacksonville, so it was good for him. Sam has started the last six games for us after coming off the bench in the first 10. And him, combined with Osinachi Smart in the middle, have really done a nice job in the post. Sam's more like a stretch four, guy that can step out, knock down the outside shot, and he really has a nice soft touch around the rim. So it's good to see him kind of finally start to settle in, be healthy, and really been playing solid basketball over the last 2 weeks.
Exactly. Well, Everett, I know you're on the bus. I hope you guys have a safe trip down to Elon, and hopefully the game is good tomorrow night, and I hope to see you. Probably you guys come up here to Towson probably at the end of the year, right?
I think the Towson trip is at the end of the month. So I believe it's like January 29th, 30th, or around February 1st.
Yeah, something like
somewhere
that.
Around there. But yeah, looking forward to seeing you there.
All right, man. Well, have safe travels, and we'll talk to you soon.
All right, thanks, Chris. You too.
All right, we'll be right back here with our good friend Nick Curran, who is the voice of the women's basketball for Louisville. They're heading down to Miami this weekend, tomorrow, to play the Hurricanes. We'll be right back here on the Sports Desk here on HerbFM Sports Radio. Alright, folks, welcome back to the Sports Desk here on HerbFM Sports Radio. If you're listening to us in Harrisburg, Virginia, thank you so much for joining us. Speaking of that, we'll preview that JMU versus North Dakota State title game around the 9 o'clock hour. Can I talk to both beat writers of both teams? But right now we have Nick Kern with us, the voice of the Louisville women's basketball. They're rolling in, number 7 in the country, taking on the Miami. They're going down there in Miami right now, taking on the Hurricanes. Do they call them the Lady Hurricanes, or what do they call Miami's team in the women's game?
They are just the Hurricanes.
Just the Hurricanes.
We are simply the Cardinals. They are simply the Hurricanes.
Okay, I was just wondering about that today. I was like, what are they supposed to call them? The Hurricanes for football, and then because I know Florida State had for a while. Florida State with women's team was like the Lady Noles or something like that, Yeah.
There's still some teams that have that out there, like the Lady Vols of Tennessee, the Lady Tops at my alma mater in Western Kentucky, but. These two programs are just roll with the same nickname throughout. Kind of keeps things easy.
Yeah. Well, let's talk about you guys. Number 7 in the country, 14-1 on the season. You guys had a 3-0 in the conference. What's been going well for you guys? I know you're broadcasting, but it looks like Jeff has Coach Waltz has a lot of good players coming through that system.
Yeah, certainly. It's quite the program he's built in his 13 years at Louisville, and this year is kind of a different year. He's talked about it a lot. In the past, he's often had kind of one dominant scorer, Angel McCautry, the greatest to play at Louisville. Shoni Schimmel, Asia Durr was incredible in the number 2 overall draft pick in the WNBA draft, and she's gone. So it's a team that is, kind of trying to find its way without maybe that dominant superstar player, but Dana Evans has been really, really good. The junior from Gary, Indiana, she's averaging 18.5 a game to lead the team, was the 6th player of the year in the ACC last year and has stepped into the starting role and has really taken up that mantle well. She had 27 points a couple of games ago at Clemson and hit a career high 7 threes, and then Jasmine Jones, the senior, just went over 1,000 points in the Cards win Sunday against Duke, and she scored 26 in that game, which is a career high. She's been playing very well. She's a team second league scorer and a 4-year player, it's kind of been a rotating cast of different players that have stepped up at different times. Kylie Shook is on the interior. A forward, a senior, she has stepped up and had some big games this year, particularly against Oregon when the Cards knocked off the number 1 Ducks in the Virgin Islands and really hit some big shots at Kentucky as well. And Elizabeth Ballygoon, one of the transfers from Georgia Tech, has stepped up and had some big games. So it's really been kind of a rotating cast of characters in terms of who's going to step up and be the key player on a given night. And Cards have been fortunate to be able to pull out a lot of close games, expecting a lot more as the ACC moves along. But there's been a lot of grinders so far, and they've come out on the winning end more often than not.
Yeah, people don't realize Miami has given Louisville, you guys, a lot of fits over the years. Like last year, you guys lost to them at home, 79-73. So this could be another, I don't want to call it a trap game or whatever people call them, because you got to wait for us on Sunday. But you guys don't do well, away from, the center there in Louisville.
Yeah, it should be a tough game. They're really good. They have Beatrice Mompremier, who's the preseason player of the year in the ACC. She missed their last game against Florida State with a foot injury and kind of day-to-day. We'll see if she goes tomorrow. But they're a talented team that moves the ball well. They're undefeated this year when they have 15 or more assists in a game. So I think that'll be kind of the key number to watch, Miami's assist total. They're 7-0 when they have 15 or more. They're only 2-5 when they don't. So we'll see if the Cards can kind of disrupt that defensively. Louisville's really been good at clamping down opponents in ACC play, tops in the league in terms of holding their opponents to low scores. And Louisville has been really good on the road. It seems like Miami always plays the Cards close, but Louisville 16-1, going back to 17-18 on the road in the ACC. So with the one loss being at number 1 Notre Dame last year. So trying to keep that trend going. This team has played well on the road under Jeff Wohls more often than it hasn't, and especially over the last few years, and these Miami games have been really close over the last 3 or 4 years or so. So expecting nothing different tomorrow night here. They'll probably have a good crowd, and we'll be ready to go.
Well, I was looking at the schedule. You guys, February 2nd, taking on the women's national team. That's going to be hard for Jeff because he works with the women's national team as well. So what does he do for that game?
Yeah, I think it's just going to be a really cool opportunity for some of the legends of the game to be in Louisville and for people to come out and see them. The roster that Team USA will have just got announced today, of course. For Louisville fans, the highlight of seeing that Angel McCautry will be back and playing. She played her home games at Freedom Hall when she was playing for Louisville, but the really undisputed greatest player in program history will get a chance to play against her former team at the KFC Yum Center. And it's going to be a really cool day, and I think that's what it's all about for him. I think he just wants his players to appreciate the opportunity and the fans to appreciate the opportunity. Trying to get as many folks out to that game as possible. If anyone listening is interested, gocards.com/USA is the way to purchase tickets to that. It's going to be a really cool day. You know, Super, Diana Taurasi, many, many others. Breonna Stewart will be there. It's going to be a really cool thing, and I think players are just looking forward to being on the same floor as legends and as players that in many cases they grew up watching, which is kind of nuts to think about, but it's really cool. And, you know, I think it's a tribute to Coach Wall's really good relationship with USA Basketball that the Cards were able to be one of few teams that get to take part in this exhibition tour. So it's going to be a really, really neat day.
Yeah, it's only UConn is playing them and you guys. That's all, you know, starting
Yeah,
that's pretty good. Go ahead.
They played four back in the fall, back in November. Oregon actually beat them at Oregon, and that was kind of a big deal. It was only the second time they'd lost in kind of that sort of forum ever. And so, you know, now the Cards and UConn will get their shot coming up here at the end of January and then into February. So it's a pretty, you know, rare opportunity, they'll be headed over to Serbia, I believe, for an Olympic qualifying tournament right after they leave Louisville. So getting ready for the Olympics, and really will be kind of a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity for everyone that attends and for everyone, for obviously all the players getting to play in it.
And I think it's pretty cool that they're doing this during the season. You know, normally you don't see this, like you said, exhibition games in September and October, but, you know, during a crucial ACC schedule, you have a off game and you have to play the exhibition game against Team USA.
Yeah, it's kind of crazy. It's sandwiched right in there. It's the ACC went to an 18-game schedule this year, so less byes. There were always a couple of byes when the schedule was at 16 in the past, but now at 18, there's really only one, and Louisville filling it by playing Team USA. So I think it's one that they're certainly happy to do, though, like it's, we talked about, just a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. And the good news for the Cards is they are at home that Thursday against Florida State, so don't have to travel anywhere after they play Team USA, get to stay at home. And I think that'll help a lot, but it should be a pretty big day, and hoping for a really, really electric crowd that day to see some legends of the game for what really will be a once-in-a-lifetime chance.
Exactly. Well, folks, if you want to watch this game, it's tomorrow night, 8 o'clock, Miami versus Louisville, women's basketball on the ACC network. It's going to be an interesting game on the ACC network. So, Nick, or if you want to listen to Nick. Nick, are you guys on the TuneIn app, or how can people listen to you?
Yeah, we are. I think the easiest way is on the iHeart app people want to to listen that way. We're on the iHeartRadio app, 790 WKRD AM in Louisville, 790 KRD. It'll come up on the app, and tune in that way. Adrian Johnson and I will have it starting a little bit before 7:40 tomorrow night.
That's cool. And if you want to turn down the TV sound, listen to Nick, or if you want to listen to Pam Ward and Debbie Antonelli doing the broadcast on the ACC network. So, Nick, I hope you enjoy the weather down there in Miami, because it's going to get colder probably when you get home, probably. But, yeah, enjoy the sunshine.
We certainly will. Appreciate it.
All right, man. We'll be right back here on the Sports Desk here on HerbFM Sports Radio in a couple minutes. Let me try that.
I've got the perfect life. Three swell kids, lots of toys, and a lovely wife. I fly, I sail, I throw caution to the wind. Drift like a stratus cloud above the Caribbean. But every now and then, the dragons come to call. Just when you least expect it, you'll be dodging cannonballs. I've seen too much not to stay in touch with a world made of love and luck. I got a big suspicion about ammunition. I never forget to duck. Come back, back to Jamaica. Don't you know we made a big mistake? We'd be so sad if you told us goodbye. And we promise not to shoot you out of the sky. Kind you want to toast. We were treetop flying, moving west along the coast. Then we landed in the water, just about my favorite thrill. When some asshole started firing as we taxied to Negril. About to lose my temper as I endeavor to explain. We had only come for chicken, we were not the ganja plane. Well, you should have seen their faces when they finally realized we were not some coked up cowboys sporting guns and alibis. Come back, back to Jamaica. Don't you know we made a big mistake? We'd be so sad if you told us goodbye.
All right, folks, welcome back to the Sports Desk here on HerbFM Radio. Little Jimmy Buffett here on a cold night here in Baltimore. We got Scott Rapidinus with us, the sports columnist for The Advocate down there in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. We're going to preview the national championship game between LSU and Clemson, Tigers versus Tigers. So, Scott, thanks for joining us. These guys like to play each other in bowl games, but, you know, they don't play in a regular season game until the next couple of years from now, but... let's talk about this game coming up on Monday.
Well, you know, it's one versus three in the playoff. The number one seed and the number three seed have never won in the college football playoff yet, but that will change Monday night. Two 14-0 teams, LSU trying to still bury the ghosts of the 2011 season when they were undefeated and lost to Alabama in New Orleans in the BCS championship game, 21-0, and Clemson is going for back-to-back titles, which would be a first in the CFP era, 30-0, be a pretty remarkable achievement. Both these are high-achieving teams. It looks like a great matchup.
Yeah. Let's talk about these two teams played each other the first time in 1959 in the Sugar Bowl. So I guess they're used to being in New Orleans, you know, these two teams.
Yeah, that was after LSU's first national championship season, which was 1958. Back then, you didn't have to win the bowl game to be the national champion. In fact, LSU's coach accepted the Associated Press national championship trophy at a banquet the night before the game. So that was a game 7-0. LSU beat Clemson that day. So a very defensive-dominated game. Billy Cannon, who was LSU's first Heisman Trophy winner, threw a touchdown pass. It's going to be a little more than 7-0 Monday night.
Right. Yeah, it has to be more than 7. It can't be like a couple of years ago when you guys played Alabama. Was it like 7-3 or something like that in the going into the fourth quarter, the last time the national championship was in the Sugar Bowl?
LSU beat Alabama 9-6.
Yeah, something like that. Yeah, that was the game.
3 field goals to 2 in Tuscaloosa. Then Alabama beat LSU 21-0 in Baton Rouge in New Orleans. Yes.
Right. Yeah, I forgot. It's been a long time. So just talk about Joe Burrow, the quarterback for you guys, and then Trevor Lawrence. Do they look exactly the same?
They're both very, very good players. I think they're both, you know, pretty tall. I think Lawrence is about 6'5". Burrow's probably like 6'4". Trevor is probably a little more graceful runner. When he has to take off and run, he had a long touchdown run against Ohio State in the Fiesta Bowl in the national semifinals. Joe kind of run and, you know, move and, you know, get the tough yards. He doesn't mind the contact. He doesn't mind taking a hit. And, of course, they've both had great passing seasons. I mean, Trevor Lawrence is throwing for like 3,600 yards and 30-something touchdowns. And Burrow is throwing for 5,200 yards and 55 touchdowns. It's really a remarkable season. They've both been terrific. I mean, a lot of people think Joe Burrow will be the number one draft pick next year in April in this year's NFL draft, and Trevor Lawrence could be the number one pick in next year's draft. So they're both very talented quarterbacks. Of course, Trevor has the experience factor of being in a championship game before. You know, they just carved Alabama up last year in the game played out at Santa Clara, California. But then Joe's a fifth-year senior. Trevor's a sophomore, and he's been through a lot of wars, too. So I think there's a lot of similarities. I think you'd be hard-pressed to say one team has an advantage over the other. I might go with Burrow a little bit because his numbers have just been so off the charts. And Trevor had a slow start to the season, while Joe's had maybe one bad quarter all year. I mean, he's just been a tremendously consistent player who's completed like over 70% of his passes in every game this year.
Right. And I feel like, and Trevor Lawrence hasn't played a full game, and so since the Fiesta Bowl, he played a full game, but during the regular season, he was done by the third quarter or the fourth quarter because Dabo was trying to keep him fresh.
Yeah, I mean, this is the point where you're trying to find a demarcation between these two teams. Of it, like I said, they're both 14-0, both on their conferences. LSU won the Peach Bowl, their semifinal in a rout over Oklahoma. Joe threw for the 7 touchdown passes in the first half. And then Clemson had to really slug it out against Ohio State in the Fiesta Bowl. Once you look at the schedule, and I was doing this last night, once you really take a look at the schedules for these two teams, LSU definitely played the better schedule. Their strength of schedule is like 22, and Clemson is like 56. So LSU played a lot more teams that were ranked more highly in the course of the year. Like six teams, I think Clemson will make the sixth team they play that was ranked in the top 10 at the time. Clemson's only played Ohio State. It was the only team that was ranked in the top 10 at the time. But they've got that experience. They've got that confidence factor Clemson does of winning 29 in a row and winning the championship last year and having players who were part of that team that won the title 2 years before that. So there's a lot to commend both teams in this game.
Yeah, so what is your prediction? What's the final score on Monday? Is it going to be a close one? Is it going to be a defensive struggle? Or is it going to be like a fat, good old Louisiana shootout?
Yeah, well, first of all, you know, LSU struggled to even cross midfield in that championship game against Alabama 8 years ago. I think people will take notice of the first time LSU crosses midfield, which could be on the first play. Right. You never know. But, Clemson's got a tremendous defense. Number one, they're ranked number one in the nation in defense. LSU's ranked number one in the nation in offense. It's a great strength versus strength kind of game. I'm going with a score that LSU's basketball coach, Will Wade, who went to Clemson, who got a degree from Clemson, said he said I'm going to a school that employs me. He picked LSU 42-27, and I think that's the score I'm going with for this game.
All right, cool. Well, Scott, thank you so much for taking some time tonight for us, and enjoy the game on Monday night.
Thank you very much. Thanks for having me.
All right, folks, we'll be right back here on the sports desk here on HerbFM Sports Radio.
We go together. Better than birds of a feather, you and me. We change the weather, yeah. I'm feeling heat in December when you found me. I've been dancing on top of cars and stumbling out of bars. I follow you through the dark, can't get enough. You're the medicine and the pain, the tattoo inside my brain. And baby, you know it's obvious. I'm a sucker for you. Say the word and I'll go anywhere blindly. I'm a sucker for you. Sucker for you.
Yeah.
Don't complicate it.
Yeah.
Cause I know you and you know everything about me. I can't remember all of the nights I don't remember when you're around me.
I've been dancing on top of cars and stumbling out of bars. I follow you through the dark.
Alright, folks, welcome back to the sports desk here on HerbFM Sports Radio. A little scoreboard update here. NC State and Notre Dame are tied at 60 with 4:20 left in the game, and North Carolina State was going to get a three-pointer, but something just got hurt for the Wolfpack, and we got a timeout on the court. We'll just also give you some scores around the college basketball here. Folks, we'll be live next Wednesday night here on HerbFM Radio. We'll have our good friend Ron Snyder, who writes a book. He has a book coming out about the Stallions, and you know, he also does a lot of, wrote a book about the Orioles as well. The 89 season, they won, the why not season. So he'll be joining us next week at 8:00 here on HerbFM Sports Radio. We'll be back every Wednesday night now until June. We'll be on our sports desk, and hopefully you folks can make us part of your Wednesday night. So let me give you some scores here. And on the bowl game. Let's go to the NBA here. Anyway, folks, thanks for joining us. If you're listening to us here in Maryland, or if you're listening to us in Virginia, or wherever you are, if you're in South Carolina, thanks for joining us. Listen to us, in the Clemson area, thanks for joining us every Wednesday night here on HerbFM Sports Radio. Hope you guys had a great holiday season. Hope you had a great Christmas. Hopefully you got everything you wanted. If not, that's why it's called, you can take your gift cards and go buy it yourself. So anyway, tomorrow night here on, tomorrow, men's basketball for January 8th. Here it is. That's right now at the half, Florida State has a 41-34 lead over Wake. With a minute left in the first half, number three Kansas has a 42-26 lead. And then tonight at 9:00, you have Duke taking on Georgia Tech. And then we'll give you the full scores. That's the top 25. So, folks, we had a chance to talk to Coach Krzyzewski the other day on the teleconference call for the ACC, and Kind of funny, getting, I don't want to say I was intimidated. I think I was intimidated because, that's Coach K, and you know, everybody, you know, knows who he is, you know, so you're trying to ask the right questions. So maybe one day I'll play you the, maybe next week I'll play you the audio. It was pretty funny. Tomorrow night, for CAA schedule for CAA basketball, 6 o'clock on CBS Sports Network, Drexel taking on Towson at 6 o'clock, and HerbFM Radio will be there getting the post-game audio for next Wednesday. We just talked to Coach, we talked to Everett German, who is the voice of the Charleston, Cause of Charleston. They'll be on the road tomorrow against Elon. And they're down in Harrisonburg, Virginia. They're getting ready for the national championship game for football, but their basketball team is home against Delaware tomorrow night at 7 o'clock. And then at 7 o'clock, North Carolina, Wilmington will be playing against William & Mary at 7 p.m. in Williamsburg. And then up in Boston, Massachusetts, Hofstra, who is 3-1, taking on a 3-1 Northeastern team. So that's the schedule for basketball for Thursday night in the CAA. Over the weekend, they got some great games coming up here. Saturday at 2 o'clock at the here in Towson, Delaware versus Towson in basketball, and Charleston College of Charleston playing at William & Mary in Williamsburg, and Drexel will be on the road at 4 o'clock at JMU. I don't think anybody will be at that game at JMU because everyone will be watching the national championship game. So that'll be a 4 o'clock start. And somehow I have a cat in the office here. So we're gonna take a break here. When we come back, we will get we'll talk to Amber Lemke, the women's bowling coach for Stephen A. Austin. We'll be right back here on HerbFM Sports Radio. In the meantime, some 70s Neil Diamond. Desk here on HerbFM Sports Radio. It's 8:45, and if you're in Vegas, it's a good weather, you know, good weather town there. So right now it's 5:45 Pacific time, or there in Vegas. So we have Amber Lemke, who is the coach of the defending champs of Stephen A. Austin. We had them on a lot last year. They made it all the way to the championship in Cleveland. So Coach Amber, thanks for joining us. You guys are in Vegas this weekend for the Storm Blue and White Classic. So, but you've been there for the whole week because some of your girls were on doing some time trials, right?
Yeah, we had six of our current athletes bowling at Team USA Trials this week, so we've been in town since we got in town Thursday morning. So we have been in Vegas since Thursday morning.
Nice. That's pretty good. But just talk about the time trials for you girls. How did they do?
We had our senior on the team, Megan Eaglehouse, had a really good tournament. She ended up finishing 28th out of all of the athletes here. And so that was exciting for her to kind of finish. This is the last year she'll probably do it. She was she was 20th after 4 days and didn't have a great day the last day. But she had a really good tournament. And other athletes, some of them bowled really well on certain days, didn't have great days other days. But I think that it's definitely a good tune-up going into the season and kind of showed things that we're going to have to focus on, you know, going forward in the year to be more successful. And everyone got a lot of good experience without here, you know, competing on the patterns that are tough with, you know, everybody that is super high caliber. I think it was a good experience for everybody.
Yeah. Well, you guys started off, you bowled two tournaments in October and November, and then you had one in November before you guys went off to, you know, winter break. So what happened on the November 15th tournament? How did you guys do?
Yeah, so we had our fall semester is typically a little bit more lighter than our spring is.
Okay.
And we have we added three new freshmen into our roster. We lost our two seniors last year that were All-American for us. So I think that a lot of it was just about, you know, the learning experience, trying to figure out what works for us as a team, get people comfortable, get them tune up for physical games, and just get the team kind of clicking together as a group was important for us. So I think we really saw that starting to happen at that final tournament. We had all of our tournaments first semester, we competed against the best teams in the nation, which we historically do tournament after tournament. And I think that, you know, I don't think you know really kind of where you're at until you play in that first event. We had, you know, 2.5 weeks of practice before that. And I think that just seeing kind of where you're at amongst the field and where you need to get to kind of helps you. And they worked really hard at that first semester, and we ended on a really positive note. Sent them home over break with a lot of things to focus on and work on and, you know, to improve on individually and then to be able to come back and contribute to the team. And we saw a lot of those things in play this week, a lot of positive things we saw that they've been working on over break, so we're excited to get things started this weekend.
So what do you guys do during the break? Do you send them home things to, like, say, hey, this is what you got to work on, like football coaches, you know, they give them the video and go, all right, you need to work on this, and I'll see you January 10th. Is that what you guys do?
So a lot of it is we really try and kind of collaborate with them. So they're part of the learning process the entire time. But we kind of reiterate, we have individual sessions right before they leave, just reiterating what they're working on. Some of them have personal coaches back at home that they work with over break, which we encourage because, like, this break for us, they were gone for, you know, we probably have 2 practices in 6 weeks just because of the way that our schedule worked out. We had that final tournament in November. And then the weekend after that, we were actually invited to the White House for our championship from last year.
Uh-huh.
So we left midway through the week, so we didn't practice that week. And then for us, the next week was Thanksgiving break, and then they came back, and then it was final. So we had a little bit more of an extended break than we typically do leading into the winter break.
Okay.
And so it was really important for us to just make sure they knew what they needed to focus on over break. A lot of them now with the video capabilities can shoot videos, you know, just 5 30-second videos and say, I'm working on this, how does it look, or, you know, what else should I focus on, and I'm really working hard at this. And so it's good. They still stay in contact and just, you know, let us know. The big thing for us is we feel that when we have a lot of kids that hold team trials in the beginning of January, they really put into practice over break because they know that they're going to be coming out here bowling with everybody that is of high caliber, and they want to be able to compete. So they don't, you know, kind of, a lot of my kids do not go home and not throw a ball all over break. They definitely put the work in to come back ready like they were when they left us.
Yeah. Well, let's just talk about your trip to the Washington, you know, to the White House. How cool was that? Did you and President Trump do like a bowl off or something or what?
So when we won in 2016, we didn't get invited to the White House. So we got this invitation. We almost didn't know if it was real. And so when we found out that it was real, and of course our university was super supportive of us going because, you know, a once-in-a-lifetime chance, you don't know if you're going to be able to do it again. The whole experience, I think, was kind of surreal for all of us. We got in a little bit early. We were able to do some sightseeing, meet with the congressman from Texas, get some pretty special treatment from them and tours, you know, that normal people probably don't see on a daily basis. And they did a, you know, my girls were in awe of all the different things and the history behind it. The people that we were with knew so much information. Okay. And so we're able to kind of, you know, relax kind of the first day there. And then the second day was all about being in the White House, and we got to meet President Trump. And just they let us walk through the Oval Office and be around a lot of other NCAA champions, because it was NCAA Champion Day there. So that was really awesome to kind of be in the presence of other teams that have accomplished the same thing that our team has been able to. And so, you know, it was definitely a surreal experience, I think. Right. We took so many pictures. It was crazy. But it was also kind of nice also because our two seniors came back to that trip. So to kind of have the whole team, older team, together again for one last time was extra special, I think, for us.
Well, that's pretty cool. You know, I've been in the White House a couple times with the media, and it's pretty cool to see all the, you know, they send you in this little room, and they send you down the hallway, and they tell you, you know, make a right here. And it's pretty, I think it's pretty neat to see all the old history of that building.
Yeah, it's super exciting, too. And I think that the big thing, you know, bowling, with it being a sport at the NCAA level, I still think a lot of people don't know that it exists. So we had met so many teams from so many different places. And so when they ask you, like, what sport are you? And they're like, bowling. You're like, oh, that's cool. And so we kind of made it a point when we were there to kind of intermix with other teams. And we were kind of on a mission to take as many pictures as we could with other teams. And we really liked kind of the unusual teams. We found, like, the TCU rifle team, the Wisconsin Badgers hockey team. So just, like, you know, it was cool to see other sports that, you know, don't get as much recognition as your football, basketball, you know, your big sports are going to get, baseball, that kind of thing. But to be, like, in the presence of everybody that has attained that NCAA championship was pretty awesome.
Wow, that's cool. Well, this weekend you're in Vegas for the Storm Blue and White Classic that Mount St. Mary's is doing with you guys. Just talk about your relationship with the coach at Mount St. Mary's. I guess he called you and see if you guys could do it. It just somehow you guys are already there for the time trials, and it worked out perfectly.
Yeah, so typically this weekend we compete in Jonesboro, Arkansas at the Midwinter Classic. Mm-hmm. When we figured out that the dates were coming out for the team trials and what they looked like, we kind of all quickly realized that there wasn't enough time to get back home in order to then leave again, you know, to go compete somewhere else. And Kenneth had looked at adding a tournament, something out here, especially the NCAA used to have a ban on being able to compete here, and they lifted that. So the thought was to, you know, get, you know, bowling is really big in the Las Vegas area, and they have large centers here. And so his idea was to try and get, you know, NCAA bowling out this far west, because there isn't any team, you know, Nebraska is the farthest west, there isn't an NCAA team.
Okay.
And so when he brought up the idea, we were kind of throwing out, like, you should do it right after team trials, because a lot of us are out here already recruiting, and a lot of us have, you know, student-athletes competing at the same time, and it would be a perfect opportunity for us to stay. A lot of schools are not in session yet as well, so that really helped.
Okay.
We brought our six ladies that have been competing the whole week have been here, but we brought the rest of the team in late last night, and so we moved to a house yesterday, and I think that it just creates some awesome team bonding moments. Like right now, I'm sure you can hear them in the background, but we have like a cool pool table and they're playing cards and we're cooking dinner, and I think that that kind of stuff kind of builds your team and builds camaraderie instead of being in hotels all the time, and this is the perfect location for that. And it also enables us to do some fun things. We actually went to the Hoover Dam today.
Cool.
And we're going to take them down to Fremont Street tonight to kind of see the lights and that kind of thing. I just think things like, and places like this give you opportunity to have more team bonding and more team functions where there's things that you can do as a team together. And also it helps that they're not in school, so you're not missing classes.
Right. Exactly.
So we were excited that he asked us, and the feel that he has is really strong. And of course we said, you know, yes, this is awesome. We want to be a part of it. For us, freshman athletes, we always make it about the experience. Yes, we want to bowl well, and, you know, we want to train well and all those things. But the student athlete experience is important for us, and so this is just part of that.
Yeah. Well, I don't want to keep you long, because I know you want to hang out with your team and, you know, take them down Fremont Street. But good luck this weekend. You can watch her and the rest of the ladies of Stephen A. Boston on the, they're on the Flow Bowling channel. And if you want to pay $12 a month, you can watch them, or we'll see if we can get them on next week, who is in the top, you know, in the top five to come on the show next week.
Yeah, and I also think that from what I saw, that Flow Bowling was offering a special for this weekend, I believe.
Okay.
Just to be able to watch this event. I know that it's advertised on Flow Bowling. I couldn't tell you what the amount is, but I know that that was that was going to be an option just to be able to watch the event just for the weekend as well.
Yeah, I think I should get it for free because I'm promoting them all evening, you know?
Yeah.
All right, well, Amber, good luck this weekend, and we'll talk to you next week.
Perfect. Thank you so much.
All right, folks. We'll be right back with our good friend Trevor Gross, who covers the Clemson Tigers. We'll talk to him about the national championship game in a couple minutes right here on HerbFM Sports Radio.
Uptown got its hustlers. The Bowery got its bums. 42nd Street got Big Jim Walker. He a bull-shooting son of a gun. Yeah, he big and dumb as a man can come. But he's stronger than a country horse. And when the bad folks all get together at night, you know they all call Big Jim Boss just because. And they say you don't tug on Superman's cape, you don't spit into the wind, you don't pull a mask off an old Lone Ranger, and you don't mess around with Jim. I don't do that. Well, out of South Alabama come a country boy. My name is Willie McCoy, but down at home they call me Slim. Hey, I'm looking for the king of 42nd Street. He drive on a drop-top Cadillac. Last week he took all my money, and it may sound funny, but I come to get my money back. And everybody say, Jack, don't you know that you don't tug on Superman's cape? You don't spit into the wind. You don't pull the mask off an old Lone Ranger, and you don't mess around with Jim. But got a two-piece custom-made for you. Yeah, you don't tug on Superman's cape. You don't spit into the wind. You don't pull the mask off a old Lone Ranger, and you don't mess around with Slim.
Been flying solo for so long, nobody singing the harmony. Up there just me and my shadow, no bass, no guitar, no tambourine. And I found you like a melody, you were singing in the same key as me. We had them dancing in the streets. I don't want to be a one man band. I don't want to be a rolling stone alone, putting miles on a rundown van. Maybe we could take our own show on the road. I'll lay down the beat, you carry the tune. We'll get tattoos and we'll trash hotel rooms. Baby, take my hand. I don't want to be a one-man band. No.
All right, folks, welcome back. It's the top of the hour, 9 o'clock, and we have our good friend Trevor Gross with us from CUTigers.com, who hopefully getting himself ready to go down to New Orleans and eat some crawfish and all some other good stuff down there. So So, Trevor, Trevor, this is a battle between tigers and tigers. I always called you Towson because I have a tiger. I have Towson Tigers up here in Maryland. So there's a lot of tigers in college football. So, but these are the two tigers playing on Monday. So who has the edge between Clemson and LSU?
Oh man, it's just going to be a great showdown. You know, I think if you have to look at it on paper, I know LSU is favored according to Las Vegas, in large part because of their performance against Oklahoma and just lighting up the scoreboard the way they did and putting the Sooners away by halftime comfortably. But it's interesting because if you ask the odds makers 2 or 3 weeks ago before the playoff, they were all saying Clemson would be the favorite against both Ohio State and LSU. But I think just because of how good LSU's offense looked against Oklahoma and their defense as well has looked better the last few games, I think that's why you see them coming out as a favorite right now as far as the odds makers are concerned. But you know, to me, I look at this game on paper. I think both offenses are a wash. I think the offenses are maybe the two best offenses in the country. Some people say an LSU's offense is the best ever. We'll see about that. Mm-hmm. But you know, I think Clemson has a decided edge on defense, though. Even though, like I said, LSU has looked better and has improved on that side of the ball their last few outings. You look at their season, what they've done, what they've put on paper throughout the course of the season, their body of work. They've given up a lot of points to a lot of teams. You look at that Mississippi State game, and you go all the way back to the first game of the season against Texas when that was a shootout, and we all know, you know, what Texas turned out to be. So I give, you know, if I look at the offenses as a wash or maybe, you know, a slight edge to LSU's offense even, I still think that Clemson has the edge on the defensive side. I think Clemson's defense will be able to get more stops. I trust Brett Venables. I think he's going to come up with a game plan. He's had 2 weeks to prepare for Joe Brady and Joe Burrow and that offense. I think he's going to come up with some exotic blitzes and some exotic looks that will confuse Joe Burrow, some things that he hasn't seen before. And he's not used to seeing a defense like this. You know, even in the mighty SEC where everybody thinks the defense is so great, he hasn't played a defense like Clemson's all year. Probably the closest one was Auburn. And we remember that LSU actually struggled to score in that game against Auburn. So, and Auburn's is a much different defense than Clemson's. They're more of a defensive line oriented defense, really pressure the quarterback. Whereas Clemson is their strength is in the back seven. So it'll be something unique that LSU and Burrow haven't seen before. And so I like Clemson's chances of making a repeat run here. I will say that if you look at special teams as a clincher, I guess that could be an advantage for LSU because I don't have a lot of confidence in BT Potter right now. He's just been too inconsistent. He missed a field goal against Ohio State, and he's missed several close field goals throughout the course of the season. So that could be an advantage for LSU if it's a close game and it comes down to a big field goal one way or the other.
Yeah, that's a good point. Yeah, I think it's going to be a great game. I think it's going to be one of those classic games that I think people don't want to turn it off, and it's going to, you know, people are going to keep it on. And yeah, because if you watch a game and, you know, like Clemson could run up the score real quick, and I think LSU could do the same thing. You know, if you get a team that's up 21-0 in the first quarter after the first 5 minutes, your attention span is like, okay, what else is on ESPN? You know, like you want something to keep yourself entertained. That's what it is.
Yeah, I think this could definitely end up being a similar type of game that we saw between Clemson and Alabama in 2015 and 2016, those two epic shootouts. I do think it'll be more scoring than what we saw between Clemson and Ohio State, because both those teams had great defenses going head-to-head. And also, you got to remember that losing T. Higgins, you know, on the first drive of the game the way Clemson did against Ohio State, that was huge, and I think that really impacted their offense, especially in the first half. They
I kind of figured some things out and figured out some other ways to score, you know, especially running Trevor Lawrence and using ETN in the passing game the way they did in the second half. But I think that was a big adjustment that they had to make losing Higgins. I mean, Higgins was arguably the hottest wide receiver in the country for the last three games going in. He had 8 touchdowns in his last 3 games going into the playoff. And then he goes out on that first drive. He made a big play, a 20-yard play on the second play of the game, and then he hits his head and he goes out of the game for the entire first half. And even when he came back in the second half, you could tell that he wasn't really right. He dropped a couple balls that he ordinarily would catch. So I look for him to rebound in a big way and have a big game. He needs just one touchdown to stand alone as the Clemson all-time career touchdown reception king. Right now, tied with Sammy Watkins and Nuke Hopkins, which is some pretty lofty company right there. So I look for him to break that record, and also, of course, ETN needs just 7 yards to be the all-time Clemson career rush leader and break Raymond Priester's record. So expect him to do that as well. But I look for all 3 of those receivers to rebound and have a better game than they did against Ohio State. I mean, you look at Justin Ross only had about 35 yards. Amari Rodgers had the one play basically for like 38 yards. And then Higgins was limited, as I said, as well. None of those 3 guys had touchdowns. Higgins had the 1-2-point conversion catch. But so that was the first all season to see not one touchdown from any of those 3 receivers. So I look for the passing game to be much more prolific for the Tigers, or for Clemson Tigers, excuse me, in this one. And also exciting to see Travis Etienne worked into the passing game the way he was against the Buckeyes. That's been kind of a steady storyline all season long, has been his improvement in as a pass catcher, and really his evolution as a complete back, which he most certainly is right now. And then, of course, you know, everybody's talking about Trevor Lawrence running, but that's not really anything new. I mean, it's been kind of a constant storyline that I've been talking about all season long. But, you know, when he puts on the moves like he did in the open field and is running away from Buckeyes and he actually outrushes Travis Etienne for the game with 100 yards, that obviously captures a lot of attention and a lot of headlines. But expect to see more of that, I think, from Trevor Lawrence running the game, and I think that's going to kind of keep LSU off balance. And also having to account for ETN in the passing game as well. And look for Braden Galloway, you know, the sophomore tight end who was suspended all season because of the Osterine scandal last year. He played in the semifinal, of course, against Ohio State. Didn't really make a huge impact. He was downfield blocking on one of those on that long Trevor Lawrence touchdown run.
Right.
So he was helping out on that, but. I wouldn't be surprised to see him make a big play or 2 in the passing game. And the other tight end for LSU, Thaddeus Moss, I think he could be an X factor for the LSU Tigers, because that's one thing that Brent Venables over the years has been kind of an Achilles heel or kryptonite for his defense, as great as it's always been. There have been games where they've been hurt by the tight end. It happened against Pittsburgh when they lost to them. It happened, of course, in both games against Alabama. So, you know, with O.J. Howard and then with Irv Smith as well. So, you know, Thaddeus Moss had a big game against Oklahoma, 4 catches, 99 yards and a touchdown. So I would watch out for him in this game.
Exactly. Well, I want to let you go because I don't want you to save your voice for the weekend, because I know you have a lot of stuff to do. But real quick, I want to let you know that I know you cover a lot of college basketball when football's over, but what do you think about North Carolina struggling? They just lost to Pittsburgh tonight.
Oh, boy, did they really? Wow, yeah. I didn't even see it. I know they lost at home to Georgia Tech in their last game. But, man, it's interesting you brought that up, because the irony of ironies is that Clemson actually gets the Tar Heels on Saturday,
right,
in Chapel Hill. And of course, I'm totally expecting Clemson to end the all-time losing streak in Chapel Hill, since there will be no Clemson media there to cover it. For the one time, you know, every single year, all of us make the pilgrimage to Chapel Hill to cover that game, and the off chance that the Tigers end the streak. This will be the one year, there'll be no Clemson media there because it's 2 days before the national championship. And it would not surprise me in the least if they end the streak, especially because of the struggle of the Tigers. I mean, it's unbelievable. I think they've lost, they're like 3-7 in their last 10 games now with the big loss. Had lost 2 years in a row at home to Wofford. So it's crazy. But, you know, some of those losses, to be fair, they played like 4 or 5 top 10 teams in there.
Mm-hmm.
Gonzaga, Virginia, Ohio State. They played some really good UCLA. So it's not all, as bad as it may look on paper, but certainly not what we're used to expect to see from the Tar Heels. So Clemson's been struggling as well. They finally got off the schneid and won their first ACC game the other night against NC State, and they desperately needed that one. They lost an overtime game on New Year's Eve to Miami.
Oh, wow.
In which they led. They led basically like 35 out of the 40 minutes against Miami, but lost in overtime. And so they were reeling and really desperate for a win, and they actually dominated NC State as well. Never even trailed. It was only tied. I think it was tied once, but they led throughout. Ended up winning by 11 points, 81-70. And that was a pretty good NC State team that came in winning 6 of their last 7. So that could be a little bit of confidence for the Tigers going into Chapel Hill this weekend. Then the ACC didn't do us any favors either, by the way. They got to, like I said, Chapel Hill Saturday, and then they come back here to play Duke on Tuesday, the night after the national championship.
Oh, jeez.
So I get to haul ass back from New Orleans to try and get back here by 7 o'clock and cover that Duke game that night.
Yeah. Hey,
it'll be rough.
Real quick, have you ever talked to Coach Kay before?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. I talked to him on Monday, and I was intimidated by him because he I guess he was in a mood because I was on the teleconference call with him. And I was like, good afternoon, Coach K. Hope you're having a great Monday. He goes, I'm doing great. What's your question? I'm like, oh, my God.
Oh, wow.
I'm like, wow, this guy. I'm like sitting here in my office right now going, I'll send you the audio. I was like stumbling.
Yeah, you must have caught him in a mood because I've never heard him react that way.
Honestly. I know it was like oh my God, and then I talked to Roy Williams like 2 calls before that, and Roy goes, and I said, you're 8-6 now, you're 8-7, what's the what's been the problem with your team? Is you see your team growing, getting better, or digressing? He goes, we just stunk on Saturday. That's all we were. We were just terrible. I was like,
yeah.
I'm like,
I'm not. That does not surprise me. That response from Roy, but he definitely has a temper, and obviously things aren't going well for him. So that doesn't surprise. But Coach K, that kind of surprised me that he wasn't more courteous and light mannered. But I've talked to him. After Clemson has played him, I've asked him questions before in post game interviews and. A couple of times at the ACC operations
right.
in basketball. I've asked him some questions at those things too, but always gotten real good responses from him, and he's always been real easy to talk to and real light mannered, so that's kind of surprising.
Yeah, I know. I was intimidated. I was like, I told my mother, I'm like, you should just listen to the audio. I'm like completely stumbling, tumbling. She's like, oh boy. I was like, you must have been scared out of your mind. I'm like, no, I was like intimidated. I'm like, normally he's nice to people.
Yeah.
And I'm like, just don't say anything stupid so he can yell at you. So I'm like, I just came up like, I'm like, so. All right,
well, how do you answer your question? Was it these natural?
Well, it was like 2 second question. It was like a 2 minute answer. It was not even a minute. It was like a second. I said, Coach, just talk about your freshman backfield. Your backcourt. You guys are doing really well. Do you think they're growing during the season? He goes, Yeah, they're doing great.
Huh. Wow.
Okay, coach, have a great day. So, all right, buddy. Well, I hope you feel
better. Weird.
Yeah. Well, I hope you feel better, and you know, go down to enjoy New Orleans, and we'll catch up with you next week, hopefully.
All right, sounds good, buddy. I'll talk to you later.
All right, man. We'll be right back with our good friend Eric King from the San Francisco Chronicle. We'll talk 49ers football here on HerbFM Radio. All right, folks, welcome back to the Sports Desk here on HerbFM Sports Radio. We're wrapping up the show here with Eric King from he's the Associated Digital Reporter. He covers the sports for the San Francisco Chronicle. So, Eric, thanks for joining us. Big game this weekend in Santa Clara between the 49ers and Minnesota Vikings. So this is the first time the 49ers have been number one seed since probably before when Steve Young was quarterbacking, right?
Yeah, that sounds about right. They were never the one seed in the Jim Harbaugh years, which was the last time that they had a continuous string of playoff appearances. So, yeah, them being the one seed this year is definitely significant.
Yeah. Well, just talk about this game coming up here. You know, Minnesota coming in after beating the Saints in overtime, you know, and 49ers had the week off. Who has the advantage? You know, is advantage 49ers or is it advantage Vikings?
Well, I mean, their rosters are definitely both very talented. You can make the case that the 49ers are a little bit deeper. And then as far as advantages go, there is something to be said for having that first-round bye. A team that played on Wild Card Weekend has not made the Super Bowl since the Baltimore Ravens in 2012. So the Niners being rested while the Vikings are going to have to, you know, fly across the country to go play the 49ers after just doing another road, you know, plane trip to New Orleans is going to be significant. So mileage does add up. Not having a bye week does add up. So the Niners are going to be fresher, and I think they're deeper. So I would give them the advantage.
Mm-hmm. Well, talk about Jimmy G. Coming off last year, he had a major surgery. You know, out for the rest of the year. It seems like he's recovered and he's doing really well.
Yeah, he's having a really good season. He has definitely benefited from having extra time in the Kyle Shanahan offense, which is quite complex, and it's shown throughout the season. He's gotten better and better over the course of the year. The ACL is firmly in the rearview mirror. He's being aggressive. He's not afraid of pressure. He's scrambling when he wants to, and he's really good off of play action. The 49ers run the football, and he's really good off of that, and he's really coming into his own as a quarterback here, and it's going to be really fun to see what he does, because we haven't seen him in the playoffs yet. We don't know how he's going to handle moments like this, so I'm excited to see what that's going to look like.
Yeah. What's the crowd's going to be like there on Saturday afternoon? Is it going to be sold out? And everybody's going to be fired up for this game?
Yeah, tickets are going really fast, as one would expect, because this is actually the first playoff game at Levi's Stadium. 49ers moved from Candlestick to Levi's in between the 2013 and 2014 seasons. 49ers have not made the playoffs in that time period. So this is the first time there's a playoff game in this building, and I would count on the atmosphere being pretty electric.
Nice. And what's the forecast going to be? Is it going to be typical San Francisco, Santa Clara weather? You know, you might have rain, or is it going to be a nice afternoon?
Yeah, so earlier in the week, it looked like there was going to be a chance of rain, but the forecast has shifted, and the chance of precipitation, last time I checked, had gone to about 20% for game time, so it looks like we're not going to have rain, but it's still going to be overcast and probably with a little bit of wind.
Yeah. What's up? I know I talked to you. I had a good friend of mine who does cover the Ravens. We talked a little more about the playoffs. Have you looked into the other games? What do you think about the other games this weekend?
Yeah, so the other games this weekend, I think Ravens-Titans is going to be pretty interesting, and I think everyone predicting that being the shortest game in playoff history is correct with the way both teams want to run the football. But I still I think that most of the games, with the exception of Green Bay versus Seattle, I feel pretty confident in the home team being able to win, except for that one. Green Bay-Seattle looks like the one that has the highest potential for an upset, with Seattle going and pulling off an upset of Aaron Rodgers over there at Lambeau Field.
Okay. So can the 49ers host Green Bay next weekend, or is it going to be Green Bay a Seattle 49er rematch like they had a couple of years ago?
Yeah. Well, I mean, obviously the more storybook ending obviously would be Seattle, and I think there's a very good chance that that happens. But I do think that from a matchup perspective, I like Green Bay in that one ever so slightly. And I, wrote earlier in the week on how Seattle, or I guess it was last week, Seattle's run of success has been slightly unsustainable with their record in one-score games and some of the breaks they've gotten, like Carson Wentz getting knocked out for the majority of the game last week. But you do kind of feel like at some point in time, the kind of Cinderella run they're on, if you look at point differential, if you look at the breaks they've gotten, odds are that it's going to come down to earth at some point in time. And I think with a rested Packers team at Lambeau, I would guess that this is the week that that happens.
Yeah, that's true. Well, Eric, thank you so much for coming on tonight, and I hope you enjoy the game this weekend. It's going to be fun. Hopefully all the games this weekend in the NFL will be great.
Yeah, I think so too. Thanks again for having me on.
All right, folks, that's the end of the show tonight. Thanks for joining us. Thanks for all our guests to join us, like Bill O'Neill and Eric King from the San Francisco Chronicle, and Jeff Riggles from the11thframe.com. We'll see you guys next Wednesday night here at 7 o'clock Eastern Time on HerbFM Sports Radio. Now, until then, have a great night.